Well, David, to talk about egophoricity, which is the same thing as conjunct disjunct, except better. in noir and English, and who knows what else. Thank Welcome
you.
Back, David.
Thank you, Scott. Thanks to the graduate students. Thank you for bringing me here. I really appreciate it. Some things don't change. Scott, for example, is still as brilliant as ever. All right, so I'm going to talk about egophoricity. I promised I would not use the terms conjunct, disjunct throughout my entire talk, but Scott has already brought the terms up. Part of what I hope to be able to conclude at the end is that those terms are really not useful, and even though the early literature used those terms, we're going to put those terms to bed, hopefully, for good.
Who did you promise to?
You've been talking to that French guy, haven't you?
Yeah, I have been.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to begin here with just priming the pump a little bit with some intuitions. So the first thing I'm going to ask you is just to take a look at these two pair parts, or two sets of first and second pair parts, and just use your own intuitions, first impressions. What are the epistemic assumptions that you think are entailed in each of those different pair parts, the first pair part and the second one? So if we take the first example, do you feel hot? What are the preconditions for that to be a felicitous set, a genuine interrogative? All right, so if your intuitions are like mine, it would be, first of all, I have to assume that the person that I'm asking the question knows more than I do. All right, otherwise it's not a genuine question. Second of all, I have to assume that that person has access to that knowledge, that somehow they are in a position to be able to, I don't just assume they have it, I'm assuming they're in a position to actually give me some information, all right? And if we compare that with the second one, where if I say, do I feel hot, all of a sudden the conditions seem quite different. So I'm assuming still, since it's a genuine question, I'm assuming that they know something more than I do. But then if we look at there's a kind of odd asymmetry in those two questions. So the first one, if you look at it, so let's ask the question then, there's a kind of polysemy with the verb to feel, one being sort of internal and ambient, the other one being tactile and sensory. So if you start with the first one, let's start with the odd case. Do I feel hot? Well, that's a pretty odd thing to say. In fact, I do feel hot right now a little bit, so starting off the talk, but if I were to say, do I feel hot? It's odd in the sense that you would expect that I would know that. So in this case, the only context that makes this sensible would be, for example, if I have a fever and I want someone to put their hand on my forehead. Right? So in that sense, if the person says, yes, you do feel hot, in a sense, the evidence required for them to make that claim would be they would have to put their hand on my forehead. So let's call that the tactile interpretation. On the other hand, if you take the case, do you feel hot? Well, I'm assuming that person has genuine access to that knowledge, and all they need to do is check their own status, and they can answer yes or no. And so let's call it, and it's something internal to them, in fact. So let's call that the internal an ambient reading. All right, so the ambient, internal ambient reading, then there's a kind of asymmetry where you start with a second person interrogative, do you feel hot? And then the answer is, yes, I do feel hot. All right, that pair part preserves the internal interpretation, but if we reverse that and say, do I feel hot? And you answer, yes, you do, then in fact we have the opposite interpretation. So this is the kind of distribution that has been identified in the literature as being egophoric. Right? But we're going to work towards a better definition of this. Okay, so if we turn to Kathmandu Noir, or as we say nowadays, Nepal Bhasa, we've moved up from Nepal Bhasa, but I will still use the term Noir. There are two predicates for temperature, one hot, tano, the second one for cold, chico. And if we run these through the same kind of pair parts, you say something, chanta tanoa, are you hot? And the person simply is saying, fine, yes, I am. It's dative subjects, the experiencer subjects here, okay? But you simply cannot say to that person, I cannot ask you with that verb, am I hot? It's just nonsense. No one would ever say it. It's just simply nonsense. And for me to say, oh, yes, you're hot, it's beyond ungrammatical, it's just nonsense. Okay. Now, if we turn to the second set of examples, or the case, so I've repeated the first two here, there's another set of predicates that refer to tactile heat, okay? So I can say, am I hot, using the predicate qua, as opposed to tano, and it's perfectly permissible for someone to come and touch my, yeah, you do feel hot, okay? So now it turns out we've got two sets of predicates for temperature. One of them has this interpretation of internal ambient, and the other one has this external tactile interpretation. Okay, this external one, so for example, I can touch the water and I can say hot using qua or cold qual, but I cannot, but it doesn't make sense. I wouldn't touch the water and say chiku or tao. Right, now this kind of distribution of temperature predicates is not, I think, unusual in languages of the world. There are, I think, lots of languages that do it. But it's going to be interesting to us if we go back and compare the English. Okay, so a couple things to note here too. Tano and chico are the internal ambient predicates, so I can't point to somebody and say, wow, that person's hot. Just simply not done. But if I use an evidential ken, which means something like looks like or appears, then it is, in fact, perfectly permissible to do it, but only if I use that evidential. All right, so if we put that on our chart, okay, so what we get are we have these two sets of predicates, right? And it's only the inner sense or the inner type that has, again, this exact same distribution. First person declarative, second person interrogative have exactly that distribution. The other two, the hot cold predicates, they can do anything. You can talk so long as it's understood as by touch or tactile. Okay, so this ought to cause us to think a little bit about what's going on if there are this lexical distinction in Kathmandu Noir, and it's a polysemy distribution in English for a single verb. That ought to make us begin to think, well, what is exactly going on here? How do we account for this kind of distribution? All right, so here's another set of intuitions, all right? So we're gonna focus on the verb can or the modal, all right? And again, same thing, sort of what are the conditions or what are under which these two pair parts are likely to occur? So if I say, can I play banjo? It sounds a little odd, actually, because you would assume that I already know, but so, you know, can you play banjo? All right, now let's rule out for a second, let's rule out the interpretation as an indirect request. Let's take it as a question about ability. Right. And again, we see, I think if your intuitions are like mine, this first pair part seems like a deontic reading, asking for permission. Maybe you're not allowed to in the dorm because banjos are too loud, okay? All right. In this case, this seems more genuinely like ability, right? So you have these two readings, deontic. Again, it's a polysemy distinction. Okay. So again, here we have the same kind of distribution. First person declarative, second person interrogative gives you the ablative reading, and the opposite gives you the deontic reading. Okay. So there's a phenomenon now that we can begin to point to where first person declarative, second person interrogative distribute in the same way. In other words, they're part of a single distributional pattern. Okay, now it turns out, and Scott mentioned this, Kathmandu Noir is famous at least to the extent that this phenomenon was first and best described in this language in 1984 by Austin Hale. He used the terms for this distribution here, first person declarative, second person interrogative. He called this the conjunct form, and in the elsewhere case he called the disjunct form. Now there are reasons why he chose those terms that actually aren't worth going into because they turned out to be not a useful direction to go. But those terms circulated through the literature for years, and they kind of created a sort of a diversion. Right? And so I'm not going to use that term anymore, but I want to sort of grant him credit for at least describing the phenomenon first off. Turns out there was actually an anthropologist before that, Edward Bendix, who did not use that. He used evidential terminology to talk about it, which turns out to be much more accurate. But he didn't describe it as a paradigm. Okay, so now we've got feel as a polysemous verb in English, can, deontic, ablative readings. We've got predicate, alternations in hot, cold, two different, a pair of predicates. And now we've got finite verb inflection in both a past and non-past forms, that they all follow this pattern. So we ought to have some term for it. At least we ought to have some way of talking about it and describing what this phenomenon is. Now, for me, it is the pattern itself that I think of as egophoricity. So the phenomenon of egophoricity, in the way that I would like to think about it, is a distributional phenomenon. What causes the distribution is really sort of what I want to explore from this point. Okay, so assuming you grant me those intuitions about English, and trust me on this, we've got something to pay attention to and focus on. All right. Okay, so let's do one last little warm-up here. Okay, so domestic partnership, was I snoring? Yes, you were. Assuming that people don't know that they're snoring, right? Sometimes people may, but that's usually sort of the cliche of the domestic partnership, that one person snores and that keeps the other person up. So was I snoring? Yeah, you sure were, all right? Whereas this one, were you snoring, is a very odd thing to say, okay? And in fact, it would be almost like, well, why did your first relationship break up, okay? Well, it turns out, you know, they told me I snored, okay, were you snoring? Yeah, I guess I was, I admit, okay. So there's clearly something different, there's an asymmetry in this one as well, and it has something to do about who has access to this information and who is allowed to disclose this kind of information. And in a sense, we have sort of the inversion of that pattern. We have the interrogative here seems to be the, was I snoring? And the answer is second person. So in a sense, it's the exact opposite of the other patterns. Okay, so what's going on here? Well, what I have claimed and what I'm going to sort of explicate a little bit more today is that the phenomenon really is an emergent phenomenon. You need three parts to have this happen. The first is you have to have some notion of internal state, a kind of knowledge that only you have access to. And it's privileged access. Only you know these things, right? Other people don't, and that's where the other minds part of the talk comes in. The second part of it is you have to have something about pair parts, question-answer pair parts. You have something, speech act participants, that operates in a particular way that creates this asymmetry. And finally, you have to have some kind of epistemic evaluation, which means simply somebody has to care. When I say, am I hot? Somebody has to care that sounds odd. In other words, there has to be a way in which it matters to participants or in any kind of linguistic context that doesn't make sense. Okay, so let's begin with things we want to say about internal state. Okay, so a couple of pieces in the literature, actually in the philosophy of mind literature, that I found really useful, one by John Searle and one by John Perry. So we're going to talk about two things. One, what Searle calls the ontological subjectivity of inner states, right? And then we're going to talk about the privileged access or the essential indexical. Okay, so Searle poses this dichotomy between two different ways of thinking about what we know or knowledge. First, what he calls the epistemic versus ontological. We're going to hold that outside the frame for a second. We're just going to focus on what he calls epistemic. But he also wants a distinction between subjective and objective. Horribly, horribly vague and elusive terms that get thrown around. All right, so if you have the sound of the banjo is the most beautiful sound on earth, okay, that's epistemic and subjective in the sense that what are the truth conditions for verifying that statement? Well, basically there are none. It's my opinion, that's how I feel. So an aesthetic judgment, okay? On the other hand, if you say she's playing clawhammer style, well, given a cultural setting and a set of assumptions about what constitutes that style, it's a social fact. And it's objective in that sense, that anyone who knows that culture, as a member of that culture, will be able to affirm, yes, that's true, or no, they're playing bluegrass style, they're not playing clawhammer. Okay, so it's objective in that sense. Okay, so the next, all right, so now ontological versus epistemic. All right, we come back to the first one, she's playing clawhammer style. That's objective in the sense of it being a social fact. Now, the ontological objective is what we think of as natural science descriptions. Okay, so a plucked banjo vibrates, perturbations and air pressure, so on and so forth. So this is a natural phenomenon, and to the extent that we grant that science is allowed to describe these things objectively, it's both about nature, the world, ontological, and it is objective in that it can be verified publicly. All right, so now we come down to the last pair, epistemic versus ontological. We have the subjective version, okay? We have epistemic, the sound is beautiful, this is the aesthetic judgment. Finally, this ontological subjective is the type, my ears hurt, or I have a headache, or I have heartburn, or I'm nervous, right? So to have a pain inside of you is a fact of nature. It's just as much a fact as vibrations in the air, but it is only accessible to you. It is subjective. So in that sense, Cyril calls it ontological. It's part of the world. It's part of human beings' nature that they have pains, but it's subjective in the sense that it's only accessible to them. It's this third type, or this fourth type, that's the ontological subjective that is of most is of interest to us. And this is, in a sense, what constitutes the inner state component of egophoric marking. All right, I'm going to kind of move quickly through this. It's a little less interesting, but it's still an important article, I think, to talk about the phenomenon. So here's the context. You're in a grocery store. You're going around the counter, and you notice there's a trail of sugar. And you go around, and you come around again, and you notice it's getting a little bit bigger. And you come around, and the whole time, of course, is it's your cart. You have a hole in the bag, and it comes around. And at some point, you all of a sudden realize, that's me. Wow, who is this person? Someone's leaking, someone's spilling sugar. Who is it? Must have been me. Okay, now I just want to note that he did not credit Winnie the Pooh for having discovered that phenomenon first. I think it's a clear case of academic plagiarism, but we'll let it go. All right. So what we're interested in here is, at the moment the person comes to this realization, what is the actual form of the belief that they now hold? And I say form here because we're moving into a direction of formal semantics, which I don't want to go. The philosophers have their own things to quibble about. That's not where we want to go. But it gives us some insight in how to think about it. So it could be the case, now I realize it's that this person was me. And so I believe that David Hargreaves, son of blah, 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 blah. It doesn't matter how much you put into that description, it's still a kind of me believing something about myself that treats me and myself as two different things. So in a formal statement would be, I believe that, blah, and so whatever the subject of that in compliments is going to be, is there's going to be a dissociation. And that may be true. That was, in a sense, true at one sense. You know, there's true in one sense of what happened. But if we get to that moment of realization where I believe it's true that I, even the terms I are confusing here. Because you say, I believe that I, the form of the statement, I believe, and then the complement form, still treats the I's as if they were two different things. And that simply is not, it doesn't characterize the phenomenon. All right. So in a sense, what we need is something like the believer and the mess maker are all of a sudden the I, which is the same, they're the same thing at the same time in the same place. All right. And this is true of all deictics. Right. This is now, here. They only have the meaning of now is simply the place, the location in which the person says the word now. So it has this kind of reflexive or inherent indexical quality. And that's what we want to think about, the kind of realization or this belief. Okay, so now let's turn to the speech act component. The speech act component comes from, first of all, we have two, I think, very straightforward characterizations of what a declarative and interrogative are. The speaker assumes, now there's all kinds of variations, the conversational analysis literature, they wouldn't let me get away with this, but I'm going to do it anyway. There are canonical questions and there are canonical statements, right? And they follow these principles, okay? Now, so in face-to-face interaction, there is something the same about first declarative, second interrogative, in that the authority, the epistemic authority, or the epistemic source that's understood in that interaction resides either with the first person declarative or the second person interrogative. There's something unified there. Now, I guess I am a little bit, I identified this, I called it epistemic source in 1991, And it didn't really, it didn't catch on. The term did not catch on until people started renaming it in 2004, 2008. But I think it's a real phenomenon. And I think it's an important part of what we talk about when we talk about egophoricity. Okay, so the epistemic source, it's a function of of the canonical nature of questions and statements and the reciprocal process of question-answer. Now, conversations are made up of a lot more than questions and answers, but at least it is one prototypical adjacency pair, and they are typically reciprocal and ongoing. Okay. All right, so they're reciprocal, they're ongoing in conversations. In the first declarative, the speaker ascribes the epistemic authority to self. In the question, the speaker ascribes the epistemic authority to the addressee. And of course, this assumes that there, in the declarative, there's a first-person argument role, and in the question, there's a second-person argument role. So in a sense, what really needs to line up is not the speaker, but the epistemic authority matches the argument role. Okay. Now, in the literature, they talked about this a little bit, and this is the kind of thing, this is the way they talked about it. And I think Nicholas Ternadra talked about it in terms of, he called it the rule of anticipation, right? So the form in the Hale originally, the form in the question, it's 84 actually, not 1980, determined by the form anticipated in the answer. Now notice, I think it's an odd way of thinking about it. So I'm giving you this form in second person in the expectation that you're going to return with the answer as a declarative in that form. That seems odd to me. And yet everybody seems to describe it. Bendix described it that way, and even in the latest literature, okay? Anticipation of the answer, which normally... Now, I think that there's a kind of first-person bias here. I think it happens to all of us in descriptions, but we tend to think of linguistic phenomenon from the first-person point of view, from the speaker's point of view, and I think this reflects that. You could just as well turn it around and call it the rule of epistemic continuity. In other words, you're attributed a certain kind of evidential authority or epistemic authority, and you simply comply with that in terms of a kind of continuity. I think that makes more sense. I tried writing a paper on this, and I couldn't get it. I couldn't quite make it work. In other words, I couldn't come up with the argumentation that was convinced, that made me convince myself, but I still think it's right. All right. Okay, so finally, the notion of epistemic evaluations, we have to care what's going on. In other words, we have to care that it's simply kind of impolite, or there's something wrong about declaring other people's interstates in front of them. And we do find that, and we've had this all the time. Little kids are cranky, and we go, oh, you're just tired. Okay. Well, you can say that to a five-year-old. Try saying it to your partner. Okay. Right. It doesn't work. Okay. Right. It just doesn't work. And so we have to have a set of values that recognizes there's something wrong here. Okay. Some of these assumptions are just garden variety Gricean pragmatic assumptions. Right. But there we need to have a way of explaining that the formal distributions actually respond to these conditions. So it's formal in some sense. It has formal manifestations, let's say. All right, here's a great quote from Austin, who was sort of the founder of pragmatics in a sense. And he gives exactly the kind of situation that we've been talking about. All right, so he said, I'm feeling pretty moldy. I didn't know that term before, but now I like it, okay? I'm feeling pretty moldy. And you say to me, no, you're not. Okay, and I go, well, I said, well, how can you say that? And they say, well, I'm just stating that you're not, okay? But his move is not to say, well, I deny it. He's saying, how can you even make that claim at all? It's not even a truth verifiable claim. There's something clearly wrong here. All right, so let's just talk Gricean, and these are sort of garden variety Gricean interpretations. When I teach the intro class, I simply cannot convince the students that when they call them the maxims, they're like politeness rules. They're not politeness rules, right? They are a set of assumptions that everyone in the social interaction has, such that they give shared interpretations, or they generate shared inferences. It's a much more difficult way of explaining it than follow these rules and you'll be a good speaker. You'll be a nice, polite person, which is not what the Gricean maxims are. Okay, so the quality, you can't make assertions without appropriate evidence or access, all right? So in our case, you can't know someone's interstate, and you only have access to their interstates through overt behavior. The inverse of that is the quantity. It assumes that I have access to my interstates, and it's appropriate for me to give the appropriate amount of information of my interstates, but not more so. Now, this is tremendously flexible across culture. The anthropological literature is full of descriptions of places in the world where talking about your own inner life is just rude. It's just, I mean, it's boring most of all, but it's rude. And so there. This is clearly not a universal, but certainly on some degrees of more or less, it is assumed that the person has access, and if it were necessary to, so they would be the person that would have to offer up this information. Okay, so now if we go back to our examples of the canon field, all right, so the quality maxim says you can't know someone else's interstates, all right? So when someone says you can play guitar, that flaunts the maxim. In other words, it's like I am acting as if I know. Or if I say, boy, you feel hot, that's acting as if I know, so I'm flaunting the maxim. What happens when you flaunt the maxims? You generate implicatures. The implicatures that generate in this case is cancel the ablative interpretation, choose the deontic. And in the case of cancel the internal sense, choose the tactile sense. Okay? So this to me is a very straightforward way of accounting for what goes on. Now you could argue, for example, that in the deontic and ablative and epistemic readings of English modals are more, there's more going on, they're not grammaticalized, but they're conventionalized in certain ways, but I still think the phenomenon holds, and I think it's certainly true of the verb to feel. Okay, quantity, all right, so it's exactly the opposite, all right, people have access to their internal states, so if I say, can I play guitar? I'm flaunting the maxim. I'm supposed to know whether I play guitar, that's sort of the default. So if I flaunt the maxim, then that means, oh, this must be the deontic reading. And if I say, do I feel hot? Again, I'm flaunting the maxim. That must mean then that I am attributing the evidential authority to you, in which case the tactile reading emerges. Okay. All right. Last example is one of my favorites. So there's a fantastic song, and maybe if we're lucky some days, Spike may sing this one for us on some occasion or another, but am I blue, am I blue, all right? So it's obvious that these lines are interpreted as rhetorical or ironic, okay? Why? Because people should know whether they feel blue or not, okay? So we recognize that this is ironic, but the question is why? Now here's where I wanna, for Matt's sake, I want to make fun of English majors, or at least former English majors here. I teach in the English department, so English majors, it's like, they're all about the irony and the rhetoric. It's like, oh, yeah, boy, we can tell you all you want to know about this irony. But you ask them, well, why is it ironic? And they go, well, no, that's just the way it is, and that's what's meaningful. But they simply are never trained to go beyond that question, okay? But we are. We're special, right? Okay. Yeah, right, okay. Okay, all right, so I think it's pretty straightforward, all right? Quantity-wise, the speaker's interrogative form flaunts the maxim by asking about their own inner state. They are expected to already have that accessible, and so in a sense they're flaunting that. And the flaunting creates a kind of implicature. In addition, if you go back, the rest of the stanza is really, can't you tell? Look at me, look at me, look at me. Again, this is exactly what we're looking for because the person is appealing to this external evidence altogether. That makes irony, right? I should know. I'm asking you whether I do or not. I'm asking you to confirm it. This is pretty ironic. Okay, so here's my definition of egophoricity. It's an emergent distribution. In other words, it comes out of the interaction of these functional domains, right? And it's a function of intersubjective coordination. Now, I hate to use that term intersubjective because then it feels like we're really going off into la la land, all right? but it's a real phenomenon. In other words, in any kind of assertion, any kind of act of communication, it has to be the case that I know that you know that when I make a utter a certain utterance, that you're going to know just exactly what I meant by that utterance, and that I know that you know that I know that you know that I know that you know. In a sense, there is a phenomenon here that is extra individual, and I think we miss that a lot. This is where the anthropological and some of the conversational analysis literature, I think, is a great contribution. So this is the phenomenon, as I sort of understand it anyway. Okay, so this is, now we're gonna turn to some Kathmandu Noir data, and I think I'm gonna have time here. So we've already looked at the temperature predicates, we've already looked at finite verb inflection, we'll take a quick look at some more data there. I wanna end up with this last number 3. Okay, so here, this is the data we've already looked at. The point here, I think, is to see this asymmetric distribution. Now we can explain it by looking at these 3 parameters, the notion of interstate, the notion of epistemic source, and simply that it matters that you do one versus the other, that it registers in the domain of the of what it means to be a speaker of this language and to use that language. Okay, and here is, the finite paradigm. So let's look at some examples. All right, so this is my description. It's pretty straightforward. First of all, for the inflectional morphology of the verb, you have to assume that the verb is volitional. That's a given. You know that from 3 different classes of verbs that you can perform various tests on. Most interesting to us, the first A and B are pretty much lexically set. There's not a lot of room there. But this third category, A and C are mostly fixed. B is a class of verbs that are a little bit more flexible to very small set of verbs, but you can use either form and you'll get certain kinds of interpretations. So here's an example. All right, so the verb to meet, etymologically it's really with or an associative marker, and to be situated. And if I use the egophoric form, I get the interpretation that I did it on purpose. Okay. The way I've interpreted this is that you understand that for this particular verb, there's the potential that the action can be self-initiated, but not just self-initiated as a sort of generalized agency, but more than that there has to be a mental representation involved. In other words, I have to not just initiate some event, it has to be the very event that I represented to myself in some, again, unconscious, that sounds pretty weird, or that just sounds awfully inaccessible, but at least this is how, in the philosophy of mind literature, this is how they talk about intention. It has to have a representational, you have to represent some version of the action to yourself in such a way that the action you perform fulfills the criteria of that representation. All right. So it's intentional if the behavior conforms to this self-representation. The term that I use comes from Searle. It's called intention in action. It's clearly a private interstate, right? Only you know whether that's exactly what you meant to do. All right, now if we look at another example, same verb. If we put just the plain perfective, which is the non-egophoric version, you get non-intentional. I ran into him. I didn't plan it, but there he was. Okay. So in a sense, the behaviors are the same. What's different is that one was guided by a representation or expectation, the other one not. Okay. All right. Now, there is a sort of default assumption: first person speaker, first person subject or agent with volitional verbs. There is the assumption is you know that you did it volitionally, right? So how do you cancel that? Well, there's at least 3 different ways. Visual evidential, looks like I drank too much, okay? Did I drink too much? Question. And hearsay evidential, they say that I drank too much. Now, when I first investigated this, Austin Hale had focused on volitional action, I knew what I was looking for, and I didn't exactly twist their arm, but all my informants would say, oh, no, yeah, that's exactly right. You didn't do it on purpose. Basically, because I fed them the answer, okay? Bad field work practice, obviously. Okay, so what I discovered later is, in fact, there's all kinds of interpretations here. All that matters is that I am simply deferring the epistemic authority to someone else. It could be all kinds of things could have happened, and I can make all kinds of scenarios that don't have anything to do with whether I did it on purpose. It's simply I'm not in the position to report it as a egophoric in that personal knowledge or direct essential indexical kind of way. So they end up getting the perfective non-ego form. Okay, so the last data here focuses on a causative form with a particular auxiliary. So this is just the canonical noir causative. It's this morpheme here. It has a few different forms, but it's basically, I'll just represent it as K or K most of the time. Door open, I open the door, she opened the door. You see that it adds an argument, it does the canonical causative kinds of things, right? What's worth noting here is this, that the causative automatically implies that it's first person, that it's in the category of volitional or intentional verbs. So it does, it gets the ego form here and the non-ego form here, because it's first person versus third. All right, so there is a auxiliary, partly grammaticalized Finnish, and it's used in conversation. It's very commonly used. So here's a typical greeting. Have you eaten? Yes, I have. It uses that form. Here's the verb. And it's in its perfective form. Seems nothing surprising about that. That's sort of the setup, all right? So, but it turns out that in other contexts, you have the causative form. So you have a couple third-person contexts, A and B. In C, you've got a first-person context, but this is a non-volitional context. So it turns out in modern Kathmandu noir, you have exactly the pattern, this egophoric pattern, right? So first-person declarative, second-person interrogative uses the simple form. All the elsewhere case is the causative. Right? And so this is clearly an egophoric distribution. What makes it odd is that the normal egophoric inflectional form for verbs is a, but in this case the verb is actually taking a, which is the non-egophoric form. So the egophoric distribution is signaled by the presence or absence of the causative. So now you have a completely different formal manifestation of this notion of the egophoric. All right. So this is in modern Kathmandu noir. It's completely common. You find it a lot. It's very common in texts, and it only occurs with intentional action verbs, just like the inflectional morphology. All right, so I decided to go look at some earlier texts. This is an 18th century text, Battista Putrica Cotta, and it's a tale, the folk tales basically, and sure enough in this text you find pretty much the same distribution, right? And so I looked at another text. Well, here's some examples, all right? So I've returned, I've already picked out the one I want. Now, this C is an odd one. It's like, well, wait a second, becoming happy is presumably not volitional. Why does it have this egophoric form here? I thought, well, that's odd. And then I thought, okay, you know, 90% good enough, you know, threw little pieces, put them aside, nothing to worry about, you know, nothing to see here, move along, all right? So, but then you have the second person interrogative takes the form, expected form, and the second person declarative takes the causative. So it's except for those one couple examples, it's behaving the way it should. Right? Hope I'm not moving too fast. It's okay, everybody? All right. So I looked at another text and find basically the same distribution. It's because it's more narrative, there's a lot less of the questions, but it conforms to the expected distribution. But what's, all right, and so you put the two together and you get a pretty robust, I mean, there's nothing odd here. What's odd, however, is that it turns out there are a lot more cases where it works with non-volitional verbs. But in the modern language, it clearly doesn't. In these texts, there's all kinds of cases here. And when I went through and made a list of them, it's a pretty healthy list of predicates that are all clearly non-volitional. And lo and behold, what do they all have in common? They all involve some kind of interstate belief states, emotional states, and so on. Okay. So this really threw me, and it's exciting to actually discover something for the first time, because this had never been noted in the literature before, and it was just maybe a few years ago that I finally sat down and worked my way through these texts, made my counts, and I was astounded when I discovered this. And so it really suggests something really interesting about what egophoricity is in the history of Kathmandu Noir. It's in the water. I don't know. I mean, it's just all, it's around. So, in the light classical texts, here is my here's the pattern. In modern texts, you don't get that. So something, I really don't know yet how to account for it. What I would like to look, obviously, at different, some more texts, and they're hard to come by, but from that era, or earlier era. But what's clear is that the phenomenon exists in these texts, and it no longer exists now. There could be all kinds of reasons, because those texts are maybe representative of certain individuals, perhaps, who recorded those stories. So there's a lot of things going on there that I simply can't account for. Another one that bothered me was that a lot of these are compounds, they're sort of collocations where you have the Sanskrit name and then you have these two Noir verbs, to feel and to become. And I thought, oh, well, maybe this is an artifact, it's a kind of calquing from the Sanskrit originals or the whatever original. Some of them were Hindi, some of them were Maithili, but this is a result of that. It's something that came from the translators. But then you have, these are like gya, shia, these are bona fide Tibeto-Burman roots, and so it really can't be the case that this only occurred with these what could have been calped forms. So I'm convinced that this is a real phenomenon. This one, those are clearly Tibeto-Burman roots. All right, so we end up with this. Okay, so here's the story so far. We've got temperature predicates, we've got a finite verb inflection, we've got an auxiliary with this kind of historical variation. It's hard to really account for, but what we can say pretty much without a doubt is that these are three different distinct formal domains, each of which responds to this phenomenon in roughly the same way. The only parameter is interstate and intentional action versus intentional action only. That's clearly a sort of parameter. But what they all have in common what they all have in common then is this notion of some form of private knowledge. And that private knowledge is distributed across epistemic source in these two interactional patterns. And it matters, it shows up formally as a kind of formal distribution. All right, last couple things here before I end. Maybe I'll take some questions or you'd be happy to. So this is the sort of canonical distribution of the finite morphology. These are the egophoric forms, these are the non. It is the case that the past form actually does double duty between, it covers both the perfective and the imperfective. That could be viewed as an invitation for some kind of something to move in. And I think that, in fact, is exactly what happened, is that this form here, it was finished, is starting to move in and take over a kind of perfective duties. And it turns out in the literature, when you look at the interpretation of this auxiliary, one researcher calls it perfective, the other one calls it perfect. And they're linguists, so they're not confusing those two terms, right? I'm convinced. I know them, and I'm convinced that they're getting it right. So, and I think what happened is that they didn't pay attention to the simple form or the causative form. So in fact, I suspect that they distribute differently. I've not gone back to check that, but that's my intuition. All right, so this is an interesting grammatical an invasion of a paradigm. It's something, and it's especially in this, you can see, it's like, why would that form be allowed to move in? Well, you're part of the egophoric club. You can be You can be here because you do egophoric just like we do. Come on in, join the club. All right, so this is when I think about egophoricity. This is sort of what I've learned. I'm never going to use the terms conjunct, disjunct again. You know, just those terms are misleading. They still pop up in the literature from time to time, but hopefully from now on people will use the term egophoricity. All right. Couple other things. I get really confused if I don't distinguish between four very distinct characteristics. First of all, egophoricity, the phenomenon itself, as sort of a linguistic phenomenon, versus egophoric distribution. So English feel, the polysemy for English feel, the lexical oppositions in Noir, the inflectional morphology, the causative simple alternation, those are all distributions. Everybody runs into problems because if you want to call all of those egophoric forms, then in one case you're calling inflectional morphology egophoric form, you're calling the simple form of the verb the egophoric form, even though it has non-egophoric morphology. So there's a lot of, in the literature, especially, unfortunately, Austin Hale's grammar of Kathmandu Noir is very confused on this point. You hear him using the term conjunct for at least three different kinds of phenomena. All right. Then we want to talk about the actual coding itself. So I'm willing to say that the inflectional morphology in Kathmandu Noir, the forms are egophoric. In other words, they code egophoricity in the sense that they index private knowledge for volitional or intentional verbs. But it doesn't make sense to me to call those other forms egophoric. They are forms that they are simple and causative forms that happen to manifest an egophoric distribution in the same way that the lexical, the verb pairs are lexical contrasts that manifest the distribution but don't code it. Okay, this is. And then finally, I think in some of the literature, especially the literature on where egophoric systems and evidential systems get blended together, they're really confusing. In all of the Tibetan family that I've looked at the literature, I mean, people struggle to make sense of how in the evidential forms and the egophoric forms. Well, I think part of the problem there is that distinguishing between what the forms actually code versus the implicatures, the kinds of implicatures that get generated that make it seem as this form, as if this form is coding something else when in fact it's still coding what it did, but you need the explanation comes from talking about the implicatures that will be automatically generated like I did in these other cases. Now that gets tricky, but I think it can help clarify. All right. It's the phenomenon itself, I think it's emergent in the sense that there's no single element that codes it or that it, I'm not sure I want to say that, but I'm not, emergent is a kind of fancy, is a kind of a trendy word, it's emergent, right? But you're not always sure what that means, but I think this is, if there's such a thing as emergent categories, this is a pretty good example of one, right? The parameters for privilege access in Kathmandu Noir, intentional action, inner feeling, emotion, but there are other languages where the notion of private, of inner knowledge moves from intentional action to private inner states, also to directly experienced events, where you are the participant in your experience of that event, even if you aren't an argument in that particular clause, you're not represented in that statement. You still use an egophoric form because it's part of that private knowledge. You are being attributed that authority, or you are giving yourself that authority. And you would argue that only if you still had, if it was the same form for this as it was as for this and for this, okay? And if it also did the egophoric, the question statement distributions. And I think that is there, some of the Papuan languages that I think they're beginning to show that that's part of what's going on. So you need some notion of privilege access interstate. You need some notion of epistemic source, what it is that is common across these adjacency pairs of first declarative, second interrogative. And for what it's worth, I think it's a dialogic or an intersub, it's a phenomena that is not located with speakers or listeners. It's a phenomenon that's located in a system of interaction with certain notions about what private interstates are, and in a context, linguistic slash cultural, where it matters that those distinctions are being made. And it's a shared notions of what counts as valid evidence or what you can say about yourself and other people. And I think it's hard to give up that first person way of looking at things, and it's just hard to do, and it's to think systemically, especially in this kind of context, outside of the first person point of view on this is difficult, and I don't know quite how to get around it. So I think that's it. And how to give up the first person bias? I can't help but showing this cartoon. So I think this is really how we have to view the phenomena. Okay, it's not located in any one of the individuals. It's in a reciprocal social context. Okay, so thanks.